The Knights of Malta is a world organization with its threads weaving through business, banking, politics, the CIA, other intelligence organizations, P2, religion, education, law, military, think tanks, foundations, United States Information Agency, the United Nations, and numerous other organizations. They are not the oldest, but are one of the oldest branches of the Order of the Quest in existence. The world head of the Knights of Malta is elected for a life term with the approval of the Pope. The Knights of Malta have their own constitution and are sworn to work toward the establishment of a new world order with the Pope at its head. Knights of Malta members are also powerful members of the CFR and the Trilateral Commission. The Knights of Malta is held up by a backbone consisting of nobility. Nearly half of the 10,000 members belong to Europe's oldest and most powerful families. This cements the alliance between the Vatican and the Black Nobility. The Black Nobility is mostly the rich and powerful of Europe.
Pope Francis has met with the head of the Knights of Malta, Marco Luzzago. He gave the Pope a medal depicting Blessed Gerard Sasso, the Benedictine brother who founded the order in 1048. The Pope meets with the head of the Knights of Malta every year, usually close to the feast of St. John the Baptist, the order's patron saint. After praying a Hail Mary together, he took the opportunity to thank them for their work.
Grazie per il lavoro che state facendo. Andate avanti, per fare
The Knights of Malta is a sovereign entity which maintains diplomatic relations with countries around the world and even issues its own passports.
The Erenburg family was a sovereign family of the Holy Roman Empire of the German nation. We have a very long family history, nearly 1,000 years, and so we look at things, at the future, with a long-term view. My family stands for family values, for the promotion of our European histories and cultures. We understand the importance of a strong civil society and try to contribute modestly with our foundation to the well-being of future generations. How do we do that? Look at the website of the foundation and read what we do. I think that the facts speak for themselves. This is a huge challenge. It always was a huge challenge for every generation, and there is a learning curve for everybody. What seems to be extremely important for me nowadays is that once you have children, that means once you have accepted responsibility for young human beings, that you have to help them becoming responsible adults. We had, let's say, many investments in mining, agriculture, forestry. We have done that for centuries in many, many countries. Nowadays, if I talk about myself here, if I speak about myself, I am a social activist for decades, a cultural entrepreneur, and also a businessman. Because to pay for all activities of the Erenburg Foundation, you need to have some money. And thanks God, I have the backing of my family to achieve these goals. And let's say
We also enjoy the support of other people.
First of all, I would like to remind the public that in Europe, we still have 10 monarchies, Belgium being one of those 10 monarchies. We have, a nobility that expands, more or less 1,200 noble families in Belgium, more or less 30,000 people out of a population of 11.3 million Belgians. The members of the nobility are the gatekeepers of our living, of our collective living memory.
In the past, since we were at the top of the social ladder,
Donaueschingen zu zeigen. So ließen sie sich im Kaiserwagen des Fürstenhauses von 4 prächtig herausgeputzten Pferden durch die Stadt kutschieren.
Imposant steht das Schloss im Herzen Donaueschingens, das als repräsentative fürstliche Residenz dient, umrahmt vom fürstlichen Park sowie Quelle und Kirche St. Johann.
Welcome to Nellahuszewicz, one of Bohemia's finest Renaissance castles, located just 35 kilometers north of Prague and perched above the Vltava River, overlooking the birthhouse of the great Czech composer Antonín Dvořák. This impressive two-story chateau, with its beautiful sgraffito decorations, dates from the 1550s and houses the Lobkowitz collections, one of Europe's oldest, finest, and most intact family collections spanning nearly 700 years. Come join us as we experience its inspirational interiors. It is only fitting that a bright and grand reception room featuring some of the finest furniture and old master paintings would be reserved for welcoming only the most important guests and visitors to the castle. All under the watchful eye of Hygieia, the Greek goddess of health and hygiene, in which her name is derived. She is depicted here in Sir Peter Paul Rubens' magnificent painting entitled Hygieia Nourishing the Sacred Serpent, dating to around 1614. Partially robed, she is portrayed nourishing a snake, the identifying symbol of her father, Asclepius, god of medicine.
The great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him.
Pope Francis briefly greeted the Spanish monarchs at the end of the canonization ceremony on Sunday. But on Monday morning, he met with the royal couple for almost an hour. It's been the Pope's longest private audience to date.
Buenos días, Majestad. ¿Cómo está?
Qué bonita ceremonia ayer.
Preciosa. Los benedictinos dicen, benito estos, benito Cristo.
Their private audience lasted 53 minutes. They talked about everything from youth unemployment to the conflict in Ukraine. As a gift, they gave Pope Francis an edition of the complete works of St. Teresa of Avila and St. John of the Cross. In a way, these items were a symbolic invitation for the Pope to visit Spain in 2015 to mark the birth of St. Teresa. The Pope gave the couple a bas-relief of Bernini's original design of St. Peter's Square, which included a third row of columns. After exchanging gifts, the Pope greeted the Spanish delegation and even joked with the foreign minister. The Pope then walked them out as they left, but he asked that they pass along a message to the rest of the royal family. During their visit to the Vatican, the Spanish king and queen met with the Secretary of State, Pietro Parolin. They gave him a replica of a catechism volume in an indigenous language. King Juan Carlos has met seven popes. He was baptized by Pius XII, and John XXIII gave him the clearance to marry Sophia from Greece, who was then Orthodox. And then Paul VI welcomed him after his reign began, and they also met John Paul I. The king and John Paul II had a great friendship. He also met three times with Benedict XVI during his pontificate. This was the first meeting between the king and Pope Francis.
The first official visit from Spain's newly crowned monarchs to Pope Francis was all smiles and courtesy. King Felipe repeated a saying that the Pope himself had told his father Juan Carlos to let him through the door first, saying, "The altar boy always goes first." The three met privately for close to 40 minutes. The Pope thanked Felipe and Queen Leticia for visiting him just days after ascending to the throne. He also talked to them about the importance of promoting dialogue and collaboration between the church and the state for the good of all Spanish society. After, the king introduced his royal entourage, including his doctor and four guards. As a gift, the royal couple gave the Pope a copy of a book written by Spanish Jesuit Baltasar Gracián, The Art of Worldly Wisdom. The original version is kept in Argentina. Before saying goodbye, the king noticed that one of the photographers had not received a rosary, so the Pope searched for one himself. Once again, the monarchs used that time to invite the Pope to visit Spain. After the papal audience, King Felipe and Queen Leticia met with the Vatican Secretary of State, Pietro Parolin. The couple had already visited Pope Francis at the Vatican before. On March 19, 2013, they attended his inaugural mass, but as Prince and Princess of Asturias.
Nice to meet you.
Your Royal Highness.
How do you do? Welcome.
Thank you. This is what you call home?
Yes, indeed. Yes. Saint-Tropez home, yes.
Saint-Tropez.
Especially the summer, but yes, we share our lives between Italy, Monaco, and Paris.
My branch, anyway, descends from the branch of Bourbon of France. So it's an old family, as you know, because it started with Hugues Capet. The Bourbon has reigned in France, in Spain, in southern Italy, in Parma, in Luxembourg. And at that time, the marriages were kind of geopolitic marriages. So we have been related, and we have many, many cousins throughout Europe because of those marriages. So at the end, we are all calling each other our dear uncle or dear aunt or dear cousin, and that's it.
Yeah.
As Queen Victoria used to say, now all the royal families is one big family. That's why she was actually called the grandmother of Europe.
My wife and also now the children, we're going a lot in different places and even out of Italy, of course. Plus the Constantine Order of St. George, which is an order of knighthood that my family has.
As the head of the royal family, my husband really has a role of enormous representation. I think it's some kind of a duty. It's really, it's something that you owe to a lot of people who in Italy, and not only in Italy, still have a memory of the big kingdom of the two Sicilies, and still embodies the cultural aspect of it all. So it is something where you have that weight on your shoulders, you know you have that responsibility, and you have to go. You have to go and travel, you have to be there, you have to always hear if there are problems, if you want to help to people that in different parts of the world are asking to be supported by the Constantine Order of St. George.
Well, the title of Castro is a title that the last king of two Sicilies used also because of the Farnese connection. It's close to Rome.
This marriage is also an opportunity for royal families to get together and party. Some, like Prince Charles of Bourbon Due Sicilia and his wife, live here. Just before the wedding, we met the Princess Camilla, and she told us about her friendship with Albert and Charlene. Princess Camilla, you're a close friend of Charlene. You are, of course, also family, as the Bourbon de Sicilia and the Grimaldi family are cousins. So you know the two of them very well.
Donc vous connaissez bien ce jeune couple qui se marie.
Yes, I know them both very well, but I know Prince Albert better, as we've been friends for a very long time. That's why I asked him to be a witness at my marriage, which he gladly accepted. It is a deep friendship and one that has come a very long way.
The Prince of Monaco, Albert II, met with the Pope at the Vatican. This marks their third meeting, but the first with the Prince's wife, Charlene. The Princess followed protocol by wearing a white dress, which is technically allowed for the Catholic wives of monarchs.
Okay, this video is going to be a short video on the Vatican is going to be releasing the archives and documents of Pope Pius XII, which was the Bishop of Rome from 1939 to 1958 during World War II. And he was actually also cardinal, German cardinal, before Second World War, and had a very instrumental hand in setting up Nazism with the Catholic Party in Germany at that time, with Franz von Papen. I'll put some pictures in this video so I don't have to go through it all myself and you can read it for what it says. But I just wanted to go over this quickly because they're going to say that they will reveal the greatness of Pius XII. And the reason they're putting out the files of Eugenio Pacelli, who is Pope Pius XII, who is often the subject of superficial criticisms. obviously the truth is out there to anybody who researches it, that they were very much involved in bringing about the Nazi Party in fascist Italy, and going against even not just the Allied powers, but Russia itself, to bring about Catholicism in all these countries, as well as destroying France in the process. This was dated March 4th, 2019. I'll probably be expecting, like many people who know the reality of the truth, that they will bring out smear campaigns, which they've already started to do, against anyone who's going to speak out against this. They're also going to deny and minimize and defame any type of character that wants to speak out against this. Because that's what the Jesuits do, that's what the Vatican does. But then they say here, they're... historians will be able to research the pontificate of Pope Pius XII without prejudice. Yes, that, like that's gonna happen. They're gonna spin as much as they want. They tell you right in the opening line, we'll reveal the greatness of. So they're not gonna tell you a lot about what really happened, about him signing concordats, which you can even go here, you can go to the Catholic Library and just see signed Eugenio Cardinal Pacelli and Franz von Papen. Franz von Papen was allowed to get off of a lot of war crimes based on his ties to the Vatican. This was done July 20th, 1933. This is the watered-down Catholic version. If you go to the New Advent website, the Concordat with the German Reich in 1933. So this watered-down version, you won't be able to get a lot of the... real type that was put into it, but you'll see, I think it's Article 16. Before bishops take possession of their diocese, they are to take an oath of fealty either to the Reich representative or of the state concerned, or to the president of the Reich, according to the following formula: before God and on the Holy Gospels, I swear and promise as becomes a bishop, loyalty to the German Reich and to the state of. I swear and promise to honor the legally constituted government and to cause the clergy of my diocese to honor it in the performance of my spiritual office and in the solicitude for the welfare and interests of the German Reich. I will endeavor to avoid all detrimental acts which might endanger it, which means I will fight against anybody who comes against it. That's what I mean by they watered it down.
And there came one of the seven angels which had the seven vials, and talked with me, saying unto me, Come hither. I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness. And I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast, full of names of blasphemy.
having 7 heads and 10 horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written: Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. Saw the woman, drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. The beast that thou sawest was and is not, shall ascend out of the bottomless pit. And go into perdition. And the woman which thou sawest is that great city which reigneth over the kings of the earth.